Thank you again for coming, for dedicating this time of your life to gather and for all of us to learn from bees and from each other and through each other. I don't know, has everybody reading The Republican? Is this a newspaper from here? Sort of?
Yeah,
is this something you wouldn't know maybe? I have no idea. But the headline was Fabric of the Future, UMass to take part in developing a sustainable apiculture program. Did you know that?
Oh.
No, I'm just kidding. but I almost read it as that because it said Fabric of the Future. And I read it also as Fabric of Life. This is about something very different. But imagine UMass would take this on, would take on bees, not in terms of beekeeping and commodity thinking, but rather as the fabric of the future, the fabric of life, returning the understanding to an awareness where we realize that Apis mellifera, that our life depends on the survival of Apis mellifera. Imagine, just imagine. Acoustics are really good here. It has this bee-ish quality, right? To gather like this. It's centric, it's actually circular. It has depth. It's kind of non-linear. There are qualities of bee mind in this auditorium. And we probably all can feel it. We can feel the language of form already just by sitting in this kind of arrangement. The form, the language of form is such an essential part of the phenomenon Apis mellifera. And we'll get there in a different way. So what I was thinking, we have just a little bit of time with each other, right? So I thought I would hopefully be able to combine a few aspects of this and weave different layers of Apis mellifera together. Because I like to say that when we step into the landscape of Apis mellifera, we are stepping into a multidimensionality of being. Because of the unique matrix of life this phenomenon represents. It is, and I wanna look at the uniqueness of it, and then I wanna look at wild Apis mellifera, and I wanna go a little bit into, I don't know, apiary setups. If that's a lot, right? And I don't know whether we get everywhere. And you know, the problem you will have with me from the get-go is that, or not with me, but when this multidimensionality includes language, because language is very, very powerful. And I believe it requires another awareness of language to be the Buddhist phenomenon of Apis mellifera. And that may sound weird to you in the beginning because you come to talk about language here, no, you talk, you know. But it is really related and I hope it will make sense. And I want to give you one early example of that, which is, as you all know, who's living with bees right now? I forgot that question. And who's just striving to be or just interested in that? Okay, all right. It's just good for me to know, you know, your background and that also leads me to say, if there's something not clear, just raise your hand and then I can clarify, okay? So, back to the example I want to play with is the word worker bee, right? This is, we would probably, it's extremely likely that we will not question that word. But the power of this word has to do with that it makes, no one as omen, it makes this element of the honeybees into something very specific, and it's related to working, and that is most likely connected to commodity thinking. So in using a certain kind of language, I want to alert you to the words we use in our living with bees. Or we could rephrase it, we could say, how can language help us to an understanding of the deeper nature of this phenomenon? And it still may not make sense to you, but maybe it will at the end of the day.
We have our antenna around.
Okay. Oh, good. One more little thing about words. So we all know this phenomenon, which I call phenomenon, in the lack of, due to linguistic limitations. It is apis mellifera, right? Latin, and mellifera meaning the honey carrier. And we all know that that is a misnomer. Honeybees do not carry honey. They carry nectar. So the time when she was named, someone said, oh, that's wrong. It should say Apis mellifica, the honey making. But it was too late. And still, the word is centered around honey. But it's not descriptive of, for example, habitat. In many naming of plants and animals, it indicates maybe color or habitat and things like that. So, as we enter the 21st century, the century of creativity and playfulness, we could say, how about calling this phenomenon Apis arborea? Apis arborea, living within trees. Because that is the true habitat. That is the true habitat of this being, to live in another, within another being, within a tree. Apis arborea. Now I want to talk about a few principles and then show you a short video. Who's familiar with the catenary? Alright. So I need a necklace. I wanna look now for the next few little bit. I would like to look at the instinctual preferences of Apis arborea. Okay? And one of the essential ones of form is comb. What is comb? But also, how does it grow? And we probably all know it grows within the gravitational field of the Earth. It always grows plumb. Always and only. Also, it only grows from the top towards the Earth, right? That's the direction of the growth of comb. And the shape has to do with a catenary chain. Catenary chain, you can write it as a mathematical equation, but you can also just hang chains. And that will show you exactly growth patterns of comb. And I'd like to just demonstrate it with a necklace, beautiful necklace. So what it is, the two determining factors are the width and the length. If it's just like this at the top and it's like this long, that's the shape. If it's like that, and you probably have all seen it, then it's like that. And this slide will give you shows it again, repeats it, what I'm doing here. All right? So, for example, who has bees in top lives? You do? So, this, I see sometimes online people try to determine what is the perfect angle of the slanted sidewalls. And it's like, it is this degree and that degree. It's silly. It's silly because you cannot determine one specific angle. So what you do, right? What you do, you take a necklace or whatever, and if you build your own top five, then whatever your length is of the bar, you take, and then according to the depth of the bar, the height, you take a necklace, and it shows you the angle of the sidewalls. And it's, they're only straight because it's easier to build. But ideally, a top bar hive would match this curvature. And I can tell you this, if you build a top bar, which any hive, which matches this, then comb will never be attached to the sidewalls, ever. And has anyone seen sun hives, those straw, egg-shaped hives? Sun hives are, they're skeps, okay? They have a platform, a wooden platform with circular frames, different sizes, so that this, can you imagine that? So the middle, the center frame is like this tall, then the side frames, does it make sense? Side view? Okay. Now it has the top basket, but then this basket is the catenary chain. And the frames stop here, and the baseboard looks like that. It's a big round cutout with a ledge where the frames rest on. Okay? So there's nothing here except empty space, but it's in the shape of the catenary. And the total is probably 18 inches. So this is maybe 12 inches or so of just space, three-dimensional space, and the comb is never attached to the inside of the lower skep, so it is removable. You see, and by matching comb growth patterns and the formation of, by doing so, everything shifts, because now we work with instinctual preferences, and with it come endless health benefits. But also, it reveals the natural shape of its embodiment, and it's round. It is a round, a spheric being. It's, are we surprised? It's not a square being. It's not. I want to dip into something else. This is now, those are temperature readings in Celsius. Sorry for the metric. But you're East Coast, maybe you understand this better than people in California. I don't know. Can someone translate this in Fahrenheit? 35 Celsius is
close to body temperature.
Yes. Yeah.
Close to human body temperature.
Yeah.
Normal temperature is around 36 or so.
This phenomenon appears to us as insects. Is this correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So we all agree on that. And insects are cold blooded. Right? So, now, but this is different. This appears as an insect, and yet it displays all features of a man. And So, this is a huge topic, but I want to just dip into it for a moment. And one example is warmth. It's a warm-blooded animal, and it actually matches or lives in the mammalian temperature range. You know, you all are in a four-season climate, you know there's warmth in winter, It's not cold-blooded. If it loses, if it goes out of its temperature range, the warmer the temperature range, it will die. Only if it can maintain warmth. And it's also typical for us, for example, as mammals, that we can we do the same thing. We maintain a temperature, a specific temperature range. If we go above or below, that has critical impact on our health and survival. So, more about mammals later. Now, I want to show you this graph. And imagine it shows a swarm, right? It's a good timing because swarm season is about to start here at some point. It's already swarming at home. Maybe I'm already in ecstasy and totally lost. You know that goes. A swarm is such a beautiful time in the bee season because it is so unique and so attracting and so loving and so, oh my God, we could just get lost, you know, forever and never be found again. But also, it happens in the light. It happens in the light that the entire being is visible to us, which normally once it's in its nest cavity, it's harder to really see it as one whole being. Mm-hmm. You know, there may be frames we pull, but that gives us only a leg or an arm or a liver or an eye, but it's hard to see the whole being. Okay? The swarm is different. We can see it as one. And again, the spherical comes into place. And I want you to go to your next swarms and look, can you discover the catenary in some ways within the swarm or within sections of the swarm? And then here's the thing, it is a living being, this swarm. And it's not just a bunch of bees sitting or hanging on each other. Yeah, there's some noise out there, huh?
Oh,
the heat. Oh, the heat. The heat wants to come listen about the bees. So this being, the etymological term is superorganism. Has everybody heard the term superorganism? Mm-hmm. And I forgot to share that earlier with you. There's this beautiful book written by Jürgen Taus. Jürgen Taus, T-A-U-T-Z. And it's called The Buzz About Bees. About Bees. And he's a professor at a university in Europe, and he calls this superorganism also a mammal in 1,000 bugs. And this book comes with wonderful pictures I've never seen before of inside and outside, mm-hmm. but also cutting-edge research on this phenomenon, metabolic processes and procreation, and awesome. Just awesome. And I recommend it to anyone who lives with bees to have that book as a background. It has so much information. It's not about management. It's about understanding what that is, what this being really is. So this super organism, it is, which means it's singular, right? It's not super organisms. It's one being. This constitute one single being. And we may have whatever the number is, 50,000, 20,000 bees, 100,000, whatever. That is just how it appears. But the truth is, it's one single being. So now, back to this. One single being, and I want to show it to you in different temperature zones, or in different ambient temperatures. This is how it is organized when it is cool outside. 19 is maybe in the 19 on the outside is probably upper 70s or something like that.
65.
When it is 31 on the outside, it's this is warmer than 31 on the outside. So 31 is up to 90s, somewhere in the 90s. Sorry, I should change that slide. Every time, it's like I have to ask everybody. So, it is not just a bunch of bees hanging out there waiting to go somewhere else. No, it's so alive. It's already, we can see how this is one life form is organized without count. That is as if, in the early stages of life, like in embryonic stages or in the fetus stage, we can already see the early cardiovascular system in some rudimentary way. And here we can see that. This is already the primordial formation of comb and respiration and other processes in this. And when you go to your swarms, you can see it. You can see this in openings. Look on the surface of your swarm, and there will be small roundish openings, and these will go in and out. Yeah, so we cannot see the inside, but we can see those spots. And look where they are. And the beauty of it is nothing is static in this. Everything is, like I said earlier, very plastic, very flexible. Wind comes, openings shift from one side to the other, or if it sits longer and it gets shady, or the sun hits it all of a sudden, it is all the time moving and adapting and changing. And as we all know, is also that bees from the inside come to the outside, and the ones from the outside go to the inside, it's in constant flux. And then, of course, one starts to wonder, how do they know what to do? How does our liver cells know what to do? It all of a sudden, it brings us to very different questions. A question of what is a so-called individual bee? Is this truly an individual? Or could we say it also at the same time is something like somatic tissue? And then you have it on the other side, that tissue is cold. Here it's very expansive, it's really hot, and we don't want to go too high in our internal temperature, right? So like we do in the summer, our skin opens up, pores open. It's cold, our skin is contracting, all of a sudden this tissue forms an outer ring to keep warmth inside. And it's this fascinating world of bees. When we dip into that vantage point, that you will find this tissue has a quality of non-locality. In other words, we could say that in the absence of solidified organs, we have functions being expressed through the same tissue over and over again. And yes, we have, for example, the sequence of the female bees from hatching, becoming nurse bees, and going through the whole sequence of apprenticeship. And yet, it's not static at all, because the forager can become, again, a nurse bee. Okay?
Seems like you're describing stem cells.
Yes, it's just, there is this beautiful relation to stem cell tissue qualities, as if it's this immortal stem cell quality, which is part of this being. That's what I try to, I want to sketch this other quality of this phenomenon, that it gets a little bit interesting for us to understand because it's so unusual. And not only is it unusual, we could say, thank you, this is all stem cell tissue for the whole time. It never, never specifies or?
Differentiates.
It never differentiates. It, in function, it does, but not on a cell level in some ways. And that is, I don't know of any other life form which is organized like that. Maybe there are, I don't know. And then we have those interesting, you know, just like the light. In physics, light is can be only either seen as a particle or a wave. And it seems to me that when we talk about bees, it seems as if polar opposites are merging here. It is, yes, it looks like an insect, but we are actually dealing with a mammal. Yes, cold-blooded, yes, warm-blooded. Yes, a bunch of individuals, it's hard to say that now in this context, and yet it's one being. But then the one being, all we see at first of the one being is a bunch of insects, which in that way do not represent the mammal. So there is something of a, I like to call it a paradox, or a koan. And in order, and it's so good for us to be exposed to paradox. Because we just love, we just totally engrossed in linear thinking. We just, oh my God, oh, what would life be without linear thinking? I mean, can you imagine? And that's where we are. We have to imagine that there is something besides linear thinking. And it's, and, okay. Quantum physics. Tell me something about quantum physics and how it relates to linear thinking. You know, that's a koan. And it's so, the timing of it, or no, we can say it the other way. I think we need koans to get us out of the dominance of analytical, intellectual understanding. Just to not to get rid of it, not at all, but just to open up for the other half of life. And more cutting-edge sciences, traditional sciences, come to that edge where they realize, oh, something is missing and we have to integrate something else.
Yeah. Could I just share an experience with a swarm as being a being? I had a swarm in a tree and an empty box.
Can everybody hear him?
In an empty box. And so the swarm was clustered and they were scout bees coming to this empty box. And I was there, my wife and I, standing there looking at it. And it was so clear by observation that the swarm was aware of what those scout bees were experiencing. It was undeniable just by observing it that they were reaching down and That, and that was the gesture. That was it. Was reaching down and saying, maybe this box is where I'll stay. They didn't, but it was very clear that you know, and it got more and more interest as more and more bees came in. And it was that, but it was undeniable. There was one being reaching out and looking to see if that box was where they wanted to go. It was fascinating.
It's just to make it palpable what, you know, we could look at the linear and the, how are we calling the other side? The dark side.
Spirit.
Okay. And the, you know, the thing is, it's tricky because the analytical is so important and helpful and oh my God, everything, and it has its right to be. But it's a little bit like it suffers under the fear of abandonment very easily. And if it's edges here and I step over it, it's really worried. It's very fearful. And we have to ease ourselves into this other side. And we have to be honest with it. Because it's like, oh, this is really spooky. This is not real, this is all made up, and oh, finally I'm back here. You know what I mean? But it is real. And I just want to give you a little example of the difference between analytical, focusing on these parts, and on the other side, zooming out and looking at the whole. Okay? Just a little something. Those are just spheres hung off that rod. And if we would only study in an analytical way, we would look at the front sphere only, or then the second sphere only. But the intuitive, the dark side, is looking at the whole. You see, the analytical will miss the form which is created through all the individual independent parts. It doesn't see that. Okay, just as a, you know, it's a playful way of exploring the other me. Did you enjoy watching?
Yes.
It's so soothing, isn't it? And it's, I think it touches this the dark side. I should call it like that. But there's a natural resonance. We feel resonance. And it's not coming from thinking. It's a resonance from our other me. Apis arborea is a being which lives in darkness, complete darkness. And like I said a moment ago, the swarm comes with this opportunity for us to observe it in the light for a very short amount of time. It makes it even more precious. Just imagine there would be swarms every day. Like, oh my God, no one would go to work anymore. I went to Florida in September, and when I came back, and I said to my wife, we have to move to Florida. I mean, this is bee Eldorado. It's a 1.5 season climate. It's swarm season is kind of more or less all year long. It's so warm that bees actually live in trees, on limbs. A swarm never moves. It's like, this is really warm enough. We don't need to be very inside. She didn't like the idea. So it's a being of darkness. Another beautiful polarity. It lives in darkness. And think about those small bees, the female bees, living in complete darkness. Till the day when they something till the day they go to the entrance and spread their membranes and start flying. And who, I mean, maybe a funny question, but who taught them to fly? If there is a who, and if there is a them, but that's a whole other thing. So, sorry, I'm trying to get somewhere.
Oh,
yeah, no, that's my challenge, to be linear. No, I'm pretty linear. So, you know, it's so easy for us to forget that actually it's quite unusual for us to have that way of being with them in the light. And when we go back to natural nest conditions, we'll find there's no way into that tree trunk, because it just has a lot of little opening and then so much wood around, and we don't know what's happening inside. Or we could say it's not so easy to observe bees in a completely natural setting. We know bees from hives, from frames, a little bit from swarms, but we... So how are we, how can we learn from them when we never observe them the way bees live? And we are trying to do the best to take care of them. So I'm making a case here, right? I'm making a case for providing natural nest habitat. And maybe even in a way that it is observable to us. For example, in the form of a log hive. Yeah. So it's just a 3-foot piece of log hollowed out and enter doors on both sides. And that's what I'm working with. And I would like to give you a glimpse of how it looks like in this short video. There's no sound, but oh no, there. No, there is no sound coming. But it's okay. I wanted to stop it for a moment. I say it's this membrane surrounding comb, right? And I want to alert you to look what's happening in relationship to the outer bees and comb, okay? And also remember the graph of the openings. You still looked at it earlier? And now I have to do this thing. You see, there's an outer layer and there's movement between that layer and comb. And right on the upper right corner is an opening. Mm-hmm. It has a ring structure almost, like a net. Mm-hmm. So I came back, right now it says 21 days. Mm-hmm. I come back, open it from the, I return, open it from the back, and oh my God, something is wrong. Because it's all this new comb, but no bees on it anymore. And then all of a sudden, oh, what happened? You know why? Because, right, the tissue of that swarm was already aged, and it was starting to losing it before the first new tissue is being born. Tissue bees, right? In that swarm are old and new bees, and the first ones will die. So all of a sudden it decreases. We have a loss of tissue. You know, that makes sense? I never knew about it. I never saw it. And only by accident, because it was around 3 weeks, I saw this. And it took me a moment to... And that's what happens when we observe, when we are able to observe them in that natural setting. We will see things we won't find in any book. But it's such a rich learning environment. And I think in some ways the survival of Apis mellifera depends on us getting to know this being more intimate. And, you know, Thomas Seeley, Cornell University, who has heard or read something about Thomas Seeley? Mm-hmm. A few people here. You know, he's the guru of wild honeybees. Because he is doing all this research.
What was his last name?
Seeley, S-E-E-L-E-Y, Thomas. He wrote Honeybee Democracy. And yeah, that's a good start. All right, so I wanted to stop to say, to clarify what's happening. And then, of course, you know, you can look at this forever and find the catenary chain. You can find spacing issues and all stuff. But look at this beautiful thing. Yeah. You're so conditioned to the idea of parallel cone and frames. But no one teaches us you said differentiation of tissue, and that's true for comb too. Comb is not comb. Comb is very specific to location. An original comb, one thing we can say is cell sizes are very different. Also, the distances between center comb to center comb, the spacing between combs is very different in the core. And the first, and when you do top bar hives, you can see it, that once it grows away from the core, it wants more spacing. And then people sell, how do you call them, the strips, the...
Shims.
Shims?
Yeah, the little shims to increase the spacing, the given spacing from 35 millimeters, 1.25 inch to 1.5, or something like that. Does that make sense?
A shim.
So that's kind of the beauty in top bar hives. It tries to adapt to how comb would like to grow in relationship to the spacing of comb. You see the difference? Where they are and how they are in those locations, and how different it is, all the differences. It's a little bit shaky, no, sorry.
So is this type of hive here much lighter though than it would be if it was just a tree with a small opening?
Wait, let's stop. Say again, please.
So, you're saying the most natural habitat is this very small opening, right? In a tree?
Yes,
okay.
It does.
So, this obviously has a much larger opening than its total natural habitat. So, what do you think of that as an
effect? What makes you think that this has a much larger opening?
Because it looked
that way
originally, like looked like a whole side of
it. Oh, I see. So well, I removed the back door, right?
Oh,
and the back door is closed.
Oh, okay.
And that was one of my first generation logwires. That's some time back. But that specific one had, that's why I say entrance and cap. So the entrance has a round door to close the log and a little hole here.
Okay.
But it has also, if I remember right, another hole halfway in on the bottom.
Okay, thank you.
So it has small holes.
Okay.
But you're right, because the transition is very abrupt from hole to open space. Where in a tree, I think it would be more transitional, right? Little branch hole run out to a cavity, so it's all slowly transitioning into volume. And it can be also not as big and round, but rather long and like that. And yeah, we'll talk about it. Now this gives us a chance to see this being it as one without putting frames. In any kind of framed environment, there's no way for us to observe this. We will not see it. And if we don't see it, we cannot know about it. All the variations. So, and I filmed all this without smoke, right? Because you know what happens with smoke. This very strong response to smoke. And once there's a puff of smoke, the whole thing. Mm-hmm. What I see is a response to smoke, but I don't see anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And the interesting thing about working without smoke is that it will also change us, because we have to be very, very different with bees. We cannot do it in the way we do it with smoke, because if we use smoke, we disable this being, really. And it looks as if smoke soothes, but we probably all know it's panic. That's what it is. It's panic appearing as a soothing bunch of bees. That's what it is. And lots of studies have shown that it takes bees more than a day or two to recover from the exposure to smoke. Were you raising your hand?
Yes. A question about the log hive.
Yes.
You mentioned one of your goals was to observe bees in the natural environment.
Yes.
I'm wondering, are there any other goals that you have in keeping bees in a log hive?
Yes. Well, first of all, like what you said, to be able to observe and to understand and study and research this being. But secondly, really for me, it has multiple elements. One is to return her birthright of being able to live as bees would in the absence of frames. Frames seem to be so innocent, and yet they have such an impact, because they take away the freedom and the instinctual preferences in the formation of calm. And calm, what is calm? Oh my God. I mean, calm is so fundamentally important and essential to this being. It's, what is calm, right? I mean, yes, it is the skeleton, you could say, but what else? It's a metabolic organ. So many metabolic processes are happening within calm. Just on the basic level, it's the change from nectar to honey. Then we have this amazing, how should we call this? This amazing process of pollen fermenting into what is called, it's a really weird name, word, right? Bee bread. It's so awkward. We have to come up with something different here. So maybe bee sauerkraut? No, that's all. It's just a joke. Forget it.
Bread could be fermented.
Mm-hmm.
Bread can be fermented.
I know, but it's not bread. It's just, it has some, I mean, fermented pollen is this superfood, right? It's the protein richest food on earth. It has, looking at vitamins, it has the whole B's, it has A's and K's. They call it a pre and probiotic. It's, oh my God. But you cannot sell it. What we buy is unfermented pollen, which not a single bee would eat. But we eat it thinking we are doing good, when one problem with this is pollen has such a hard outer shell. What's the name of that shell? Does anyone know? There's a word for that. It's anyway, it makes it very hard to digest for our system. And for some time used pollen, you know, on muesli or whatever, and sometimes I had an upset stomach. I don't know about you, but, and I didn't know why. And now we have to find ways to, if we buy pollen like that, how can we ferment it? Because it's not really, the true medicinal qualities are not yet present in pollen. So back to calm. All right. Now, what else is calm? Well, the old name is brood nest. But Jürgen Taubes calls this, it's a social uterus. Comb is a social uterus. When I heard that, it was the end. It was, the first question was, how can I don't want to, I don't know. I don't know how to move uterus anymore. I mean, can you?
Right.
It's like, okay. But you see, language shapes perception. And perception shapes language. It's so easy to move brood comb. It's like, of course we move, we manipulate, we open it up and put an empty frame right in the middle, root comb. Of course, why not? But the moment we understand it as a social uterus, are we still doing that? How could we? I mean, maybe you don't have a problem with that, but I really had a problem all of a sudden. And that's the tricky thing. Once you dive into, the more you dive into that vantage points of what bees, what this phenomenon is, the more constricted you are. You kind of lose your freedom. It's really bad. You should all go home now. No, it's just a joke. You know what I mean? So it is a social uterus. And that definition comes from a mainstream scientific researcher, an entomologist. This is not California. This is linear Germany. Like, oh my God, Germans are really lost it. So okay, comb, it's a social uterus. Also, again, Taos, right? He calls it the comb wide web because it's linked to communication. It's linked to her nervous system. And one example is what is called a dance floor. And there's so much activity happening on the dance floor, but now let's look at the way the bee moves across the dance floor, you know, in its beautiful different shape. By the way, there's so many dances being discovered right now. It's not the age only, it's like, oh my God, it's like all of a sudden everybody's dancing all the time everywhere. But there's a specific area on that comb wide web within that nervous system as a sense organ, like an eye maybe, or like a nose, where there's a specific dancing happening, and the dancing is across open cells. The dance, that the old definition of dancing, is on open comb close to the entrance. That's where the location is, okay? And bees grab the rims of the cells as they dance, and as they walk, they vibrate. And they vibrate at about 250 hertz. Now, they looked at the vibrational properties of wax, of beeswax comb, and found that once it's in a mammalian temperature range, it amplifies vibration ideally at 250 hertz. Duh, you know, of course it does. I mean, the motility of our liver organ just matches the motility of our colon and of our stomach, of all the tissue around. Motility is matched by motility and mobility of all tissue. Why would we be surprised? Another one of comb is that it is a memory organ. As it grows over the season, over the years, it absorbs scent and substances. And since it's all in darkness, and since the light of this being is so centered around the olfactory, the bees orient themselves through scent within. And in that regard, each comb smells different because it has history, it grew at a certain time. You get the picture? All right, so that's just, you know, in a nutshell, the nature of comb, or the nature of properties, qualities, features. So when we move comb, and we don't know all of this, then we just move frames, no problem. And you know, don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to get you out of your frame types, and I don't want to make a case of not moving it anymore. That's up to you, and there's no judgment. All what I want to share with you is the nature of comb, and the properties and functions. And then I leave it up to you what it does for you, mm-hmm. and how you become creative with this. Because this is all what it is about. It's about to know, to continue on this journey of learning and becoming more intimate with what this being really is. And then, how can I match this? You know, do I want to do this? Do I want to look at the cow and see what does this cow really need, and then provide with the right pasture, with the right food, with the right shelter. So back to your question, log hives, right? To give them back their birthright to be themselves due to all of those things and more. And it then bridges over to wild honeybees.
Are there certain woods that, trees that they gravitate towards as opposed to other ones? So if you were to, the logs that you use, did you choose that particular wood over something else for that, for a reason?
No, I'm not, I don't know about you. I've seen these in many, many, many different kind of trees, in apple trees and oaks and fir and eucalyptus. There's a difference between milled wood and the tree itself, because it's about volatiles like a redwood and also cedar. You know, the cedar and the moth, they don't like each other in our closets. So they can be wild beehives in a cedar tree, but that cavity is crusted over. It's not exposed to milled wood. It has rot in it and many other things. It went through some transformation and then it was ready for bees. People sell hives made out of cedar wood, and I think it's a big mistake because of the volatiles in cedar and also redwood. And I do use redwood for the logs, for the vertical ones, but only on the outside. There's always pine on the inside, so many levels, layers of wood. Okay, so that out the top of the roof is redwood, but beneath it is pine.
But the horizontal version versus the vertical one, they're both really both viable options, because it's sillier. It's actually sillier to say, because we all know, there can be cavities in upright trunks, there can be cavities in big side branches. So we have both orientations within the natural world. But one thing, the more we are aware of natural preferences, instinctual preferences, the more we can play with options. How can we integrate those into our hive design? Yeah? And one, did I write that there? No, okay. One is, and the people, our ancestors in Egypt did that 3,000 years ago. They knew that. Very simple. Off-center entrance. Off-center entrance, or in other words, what is closest to the entrance? It's the uterus. What is furthest away? That's honey. That's why in Egypt they had those clay cylinders, front entrance, and here access door. And I do the same thing. And the beauty is, we will never open here at all. This will just be, it is through design protected. Right? And then we have this, and it's done everywhere in so many indigenous cultures. I went to Hispaniola a few years ago, to Dominican Republic, and they use palm tree logs. They call them rusticas. And they did the same thing, and there was so much wisdom of how to start bees in the rusticas so that when you look into it from the back, so that the comb would be perpendicular and easy to cut, instead of in the video it was like that, and then it's more challenging to cut any comb. And they knew how to do it. So just the location of the entrance shifts everything with it, right? All right.
So wild apis mellifera, a cornucopia of resources for long-term survival. Here I'll quote again Thomas Seeley and Jürgen Tautz, because everybody is completely engrossed in research of wild apis mellifera. Seeley, just to talk just for a moment about Seeley and the significance of his research, he researched wild honeybees in the 1970s. Wait, this is not far away from where they are, right? He went to the Arnold Reserve. Anyone knows where that is? Arnold Reserve? It's somewhere Ithaca, or you guys must know it, everything is so close. New York. Okay. He went there in the 70s before Varroa came and checked it all out. And then he went back for a few years. And then he went back from 2003 to 2005 thinking, all my friends are dead because of Varroa. He went there and was in shock because what he found was Varroa and Apis mellifera having a feast, having a party, you know, being like, I don't know, like in the fairy tale, happily living together and happily surviving together. So, and since then, everybody's like, ooh, wait, this is possible? What do the conditions have to be so that our, you know, dreaded Varroa is not anymore our enemy, but our new cohabitant? So, you get the message. Everybody's like, oh my God. So, and now let's look at some parameters of wild apis mellifera. Here we have density issues. How close are nests? How close do bees live? And of course, specific locations. Why do they move into a certain tree and why not in another? And we'll get into that. Nest volume, shape, and composition are important points, and there's another slide coming. Then we have the whole cohabitant microbiome and all of that, the tree womb environment. We're just like us. Not only our health, but our survival, our life depends on all the life which lives within us. When in the old days people said we are outnumbered 10 to 1, right? They're 10 to, but which was wrong actually. It's only one and one lately. That's the latest I read. So there's the same amount of human cells and of non-human cells living within me and you. Isn't that crazy? Which brings up the question, who am I? And now, the same is true for apis mellifera. We talked about pollen. We have to come up with a different word for bee bread, really. But now we have lactobacilli, strains of lactobacilli being essential for the survival of this being. What happens when, for example, we treat bees with organic acids? Just as an example, I'm not even talking about pesticides, but you know, it's kind of the hip way of doing it. No, it's not, that's really horrible language. Sorry, I take it back. But to use organic acids, what they do is they destroy the microbiome of this organism. It's similar to a large dosage of antibiotica we take, what it does to our intestinal flora. It's devastating. It creates additional stress and it diminishes our immunity. Okay? I call it cohabitants. That's a whole other thing. You know, speaking of the polar opposites, we are used to clearly defined beings. This is my skin and that's me, even though internally it's already really wild. But for bees, We have, for example, the wax moth. Our dear wax moth, which we could... The wax moth depends on honeybees. That's why we call it the wax moth. And it has the function, it has the outsourced function of an osteoclast. It takes down bone material. We employ bone within our own body. We have the osteoblasts building up bone material, and then we have the osteoclasts, which is constant rebuilding and reforming. In this case, it's this really interesting connection between internal osteoblasts, which are originates within the bee tissue, on the one hand. On the other hand, we have the osteoclast who comes and visits once in a while. So that's the Arno Reserve. All wooded area, he measures distances, it's all natural setup. And now I want to give you an example about density issues, okay? So the Arno, you saw the map, the forest was mapped. There are 800 yards in between, hives, stuff like that, okay? Now, Thomas Seeley published this study last spring, okay? And what he did, he had two setups. I think it was 10 hives each. Oh, anyway, it doesn't matter, something like that. And he set up one apiary, one was just the default way, all of them together, like all next to each other. I think it was like one long row, okay? And this setup, he calls dispersed. He didn't put them next to each other, and I think it was, 50 yards, maybe only 50 feet, I forgot. Not next to each other, okay? So, and then he started counting. In this picture, now he's looking at drifting, okay? And in the dispersed, there's no drifting. They're all going back to their own hives. In crowded, that's the percentile of how many stayed, and the missing part is those who didn't come back, okay? And now, then he started counting mites. So, that's the dispersed. Just not to put them next to each other. That was the only difference. So, density principles. That's key. Or we can say it the other way around. By putting two hives next to each other, we are favoring the worst by just putting them next to each other. That's as simple as that is. And now with data, someone like from Cornell University, he can say, oh, look at the numbers. Look. So he is totally engrossed in wild Apis mellifera because he wants to know what the conditions need to be so that varroa and bees can live with each other and survive. And that's just one little dipping into them, that biotic dynamic. And now we're looking, this is now a multilingual slide, sorry. But I think we may be able to read it. This now looks at, the only difference is the nest volume size. That's all it does. It compares big colonies. Colony actually is a misnomer. It's not a colony, but it's still in the language. Okay, so big hive, or whatever hive is. Big hive, small hive. 40 liters, that's 10 gallons. And that's 40 gallons. And that's nothing unusual, 160 liters. I think a deep lamb is maybe 36 liters, can that be? It's big. Anyway, so slightest volume, small volume, and gold volume, big volume. And they, in June 2012, both started out with two brood comb. These barbless comb. Okay? And then they start growing up to 10 shears at the same time. Oh, it's next year. 34 frames, 10 frames. And then comb is 50%. It's 5 comb, 5 brood frames. And here we have 10 brood frames out of 34. And then the percentage of whether or not they swarmed. 83% swarmed, and the big volume only 17. Now, how many were on bees? 1.1%, 6.3%. Total varroa, those are the numbers. Look at the numbers. Deformed wing virus, 0.2%. Just volume. Oh, look at this. That's so cute. Because it's a study by ceilings, and I found it in a German environment, copied the slide, and now I have to retransfer it back. Well, sorry, it's another one. Okay, so you get the picture? We have a problem. Or we have an opportunity. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know Thomas Seeley? Mika? He would be an awesome person to invite. He's not too far, but he travels. I met him at least twice in California. He's a wonderful person to invite and an awesome resource. Yeah.
Just looking at the correlations there, the volume, but you know, the swarming correlation is also huge. Much more swarming in the smaller volume, and a dramatic drop in the mites.
The swarming was 83%.
Yes. Yeah.
With the smaller volume, does that mean that you're going to have more queen cells, so that they're going to try to find a new hive or a new queen?
I'm not sure whether they have more queen cells, but
the larger one, is there more room for expansion, so that's not going to happen as often.
And I mean, that's also the idea, right? The idea is often give volume to prevent swarming, right? That's the overall thinking.
Couldn't we argue that there's more than four times swarming and there's brood interruption with swarming and brood interruption affects mite level, and so is that a positive effect?
Totally, yeah. That's a big question. You know, how important is interruption of brood? And how does it play into this whole dynamic of varroa and bees? Yeah. But is it as simple as that? But that's a huge, huge part of it.
Tom Seeley's the one that's established a hive we put out to have swarms come to. It's exactly 40 liters.
Yeah.
Anybody that works with 40 liters, which I do, just would always get filled up. And they do very well in those for over a long distance of time, but I followed Tom Seeley for a long time.
Yeah, yeah, he's an awesome guy. So, you know, what this also does is it really raises fundamental questions, right, about what are our current ways of living with bees, what is our management approach, what is the design, the underlying design, what is the design of our bee boxes? What is the design of our apiaries? It really questions our defaults on all levels. It questions also, I mean, it brings up our honey-centric mind. that it is still to this day, we just talked about it this morning at breakfast, like someone comes and asks me, how much honey did you get? It's kind of this, the it's kind of the hello among beekeepers, right? They don't, I'm only gonna ask you, what's your name? The first thing is like, oh, so how much honey did you get? And it's very hard, because I still to this day, when someone asks, so what's your honey situation? I'm like, oh, God, you know, I have no honey to offer, really. I want some help. So, it's really deep. And it, there's this old way of doing things which originates from the time of the Industrial Revolution. Mr. Langstroth lived in a time where there was no awareness, there was no, just imagine the word carbon footprint in 1872. Like, are you crazy? But they were people in that time when Mr. Langstroth designed this. And when in that time, when people started experimenting with larger cells, they introduced this concept of using implants. The modern word is foundations. There's nothing foundational about foundations. It's a euphemism. It's the what it truly is it's an implant. And people started experimenting with implants with embossed hexagons on a sheet of wax in different sizes. The idea was that, you know, the bigger the hexagon, the bigger the beast, the bigger the bee, the larger the crop. Now that there was this, you know, people, there was the beginning of this alienation, this we were not concerned anymore with instinctual preferences and really basic birthrights. And we all know that, and we can see it in our entire life, we can see it in the entire world, that kind of thinking. But there were people at that time that said, wait, you know, there, in many indigenous languages, there were words which would describe the superorganism as one being. You know, the German equivalent word was being. It was the word which said, this is one being. It's the great being. In Hungarian, it's a word for mother. Yeah? It's mother. And then, of course, when the further we go back, the more we find bees in mythology and, how you say, in different genesis, right? In the Scandinavian mythology, it's Yggdrasil, the life of the tree of the tree of life, and at its base are honey. You know all the images of Egypt and Ra and, you know, the symbol of the king is endless. And it is not, it's not those crazy irrational people who had all those visions. We could make the case and say their perception was really different. They could still perceive that the dark side and had it integrated in their life. And, you know, the whole story about Descartes and the change of consciousness, which led to the Industrial Revolution and many other things, we can see it all over. It really dramatically shifted consciousness. Just the spheric in comparison to the cube, it's, we could say it's a daily change in temperatures, right? Goes down at the night, goes up again, goes down at the night, goes up again. And what is, does the temperature inside the nest do in relationship to the outside temperature? an acute item, an acute versus the sphere, and then we find the core here is green and here's black. So at the core, green and black are here, pretty constant. Then we step out, this is red, and this is a yellow, red and yellow. Look at the swings. And then we go to the sphere, we have the black here, and this is blue, look at the blue. There are lots of studies out there which look at, let me back up. So we all know the sphere has so many advantages when it comes to warmth and the cube, and we know it all, cold corners, lots of issues, right? I mean, the cold corners make us, cold corners make us think that now we have to work with something we call ventilation. That's a whole other topic, but just in a nutshell, once we work with cubes, we have structural issues, and we're getting into stressors and how to compensate the cold corners, especially in the spring. There are issues, and we're trying to solve that issue, thinking that the bees need ventilation, when actually we are dealing with a structural problem. It's the design we're dealing with. Or now we come to temperature. Our thin-walled hives create stressors, and we have to compensate by doing things no bee would normally do. You know, we're creating low-income housing with shitty apartments, but don't see it. And this is also true if we would, the same graph would be true if we would compare any kind of hive made out of milled wood and compare it to bees in a tree, and to see what's the difference, because we have one offers close to no insulation, the other does quite a bit. And there are studies out there that look at this, they look at how does this phenomenon express itself in heat conditions in Arizona. And it was amazing to see, you know, one symptom of this is what we call bearding, right? And they looked at one or the other, and it was so obvious how easily the hive bees were stressed by heat, but not the ones in a tree cavity. So how can we work with that insulation feature and provide that insulation value? Oh, let me back up before I go with it. Now, so much research is done everywhere in bee boxes, not in natural conditions. And one of which, this famous thing we all believe in, is winter cluster. Now, new studies are coming out and they say, wait, we cannot really find the typical winter cluster in tree trunks. In other words, they make the case that what we observe or believe in, the cluster, the like just, you know, being dense together, trying to stay warm enough, that this is a reflection of the conditions we provide, that it's too cold. You get it? The so-called winter cluster. It mirrors the apartment conditions we provide. And that, in that way, we talked about this morning, right? Melissa has straw bales. Can I share? Melissa has straw bales around her hive, and for winter setup. But how about keeping it all year long to provide them with that buffer? Because it not only is sustaining their health in the winter, but all year long. Look at the graph. And straw is beautiful because it can breathe. And in particular in the spring, when so much growth is happening, the humidity levels within are just through the roof. And the wood, have you ever realized how wet wood is around the uterus? It's unbelievable. And if you use a sealer on your hive box, that wood is just soaking. If it's not sealed though, you use something which is not completely allows it to breathe, it can breathe through the wood into the straw. And if it's not straw bales, they are big, right? Maybe there are other ways we can add and help. So maybe we can try and conclude a little bit, or how can we work with all of this? That's one thing I'm trying to incorporate into what I do with diabetes. To continue to research, to continue to learn, to continue to try to understand what this really all is about, what this phenomenon of these is on many, many levels. It's so multidimensional, it's so complex. And maybe, you know, that's why I said at the beginning, I want to sketch this, the complexity of this being, and that, you know. So I call it the concept of a landscape apiarium. It combines both. It acknowledges the dimension of landscape, that bees are so interconnected with its surrounding in a quite amazing way. Every time I do the math, like 1.5 mile flight radius, how many acres is that? Anyone knows? It's over 4,000 acres. At a 2 mile radius, I think it's between 7,000 and 8,000 acres. And every time I quote that number, I cannot believe it. But it's true, I did the math so many times. So we have to look into the landscape. When we touch bees, we touch thousands of acres. This interface, has so many qualities. It's an interface. We touch this entire landscape through bees. And then, of course, we know it is important to be familiar with what's happening there. Where are we, anyway? Are we in an urban setting? Are we surrounded by GMO corn farmers, or whatever? What's happening here? What are the issues, the agricultural issues?
GMO
everything?
Neonates.
Yeah. Oh, of course.
GMOs.
Okay. Did you hear that France is about to outlaw neonicotinoids?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That reminds me. How much time do we have before I continue there? Sorry for the back and forth. But I wanted to at least in a nutshell talk about varroa. And because that's kind of, it seems like all of the whole shebang, everything got totally focused on varroa. Varroa may have introduced screened bottom boards. You have to remember that, right? Speaking of insulation, speaking of nest integrity, I started with screen bottom boards, but for what? I mean, it was this initial impulse. Oh, we need to count mice. Who's counting mice? And why? Why? It was a new phenomenon. We all didn't know what to do. So we thought, okay, let's count mice, or let's have them stick on vegetable oil or something like that, which was like, oh my God. Oh my God. We are such an interesting species. So, a good question, right? The whole, oh my God, nest integrity when it comes to warmth, humidity, scent, and having all of a sudden an open bottom. Really an open bottom. It's like I take off my pants and walk outside through the snow. But, I mean, it's good for a minute, maybe. It's liberating, but then I'm good. That may be not a good example, but you know, I couldn't get my point. Actually, it would rather be to have an open abdomen. It's much more intimate. It's not taking off my pants. It's open up our abdomen and leaving it open. That's what it is. Where was I going with this? Overall, right. Now, it is this very interesting phenomenon. Varroa living with Apisarana happily to the end of the day. But the moment the varroa mite jumped the oceans and found her new playmate, Apis mellifera, things did not look good, right? Because, okay, let's look at this. How new host parasite, you know, new friendship, they just met each other. Host parasite dynamics. What happens initially when a new host meets a new parasite, and so-called both, and vice versa? It's devastating. Two system meeting. But now the thing is that system, both sides have the capacities to adapt and to learn. But only, no, that's actually, no, the other way around. Adapt and to learn. If that system is being left alone and supported, eventually, that system, this dynamic system, will rebalance itself. And the hard data is, you know, that's a crazy suggestion in some ways, but the hard data is coming from Tom Seeley, from observations from wild honeybees, like I mentioned earlier, his research in the 1970s, and then going back, 2003 to 2005. He even said that he almost found more bees in 2005 than they were in the 70s with varroa. Okay? So that means that we have choices. We can choose either to treat whatever our preferred ways are for the rest of our life, not only our own life, but for the life of our species. We can choose to compromise good living conditions just for the sake of targeting the mite. Or we can choose a whole other way of finding the right conditions to enable this dynamic system from rebalancing itself. Okay? And it has multiple facets, and we don't know all the way. Even Seeley, you know, he's a scientist. He only goes by hard data. And when you talk to him, he's very careful in what he's saying. He says, yes, brood interruption, multiple swarming due to small cavities, but he doesn't say that's it. He says, yes, that's important, but there are, he says, there are other things I don't know yet, okay? So I find it so encouraging that we have that research data as a backup, to back us up emotionally too, you know, to give us the courage to go that way, because it's not easy to let that other approach go. And like I said, it has so many facets. You know, you saw those two studies in regards to density and nest volume. Just those two make a huge difference. They're not the whole story. There's multiple parts. But once we know those parts, then it gets really juicy. Like, okay, how can I do this? How can I incorporate those things and favor the best and not anymore the worst? Okay? So maybe that's all I want to say about, I mean, unless you have questions about varroa treatment, but I feel like, well, maybe that one. Yeah?
One of the difficulties I think with this audience is that Langstroth live 20 miles from here, and so on some level...
Who does?
Langstroth. Greenfield is right down the road.
Okay.
And so if you're guiding the goal, this is what we have.
Right.
We've been conditioned for quite a while.
The whole world has. It's not just you.
Well, but if it started in our community, more or less, then we've had it.
That's true.
He was a minister at...
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. Church mm-hmm.
Yeah. I didn't know he was here.
Mr. Langstroth is down
the road. I understand that the high kingdom benefit is not what it is today. They said his walls were much thinner.
I think some of the principles of this time, the interchangeable frames, and the concept of these states. Those are two of the elements that he was contributed in the media. Yeah.
But somebody had said to me that the way he wanted to rebuild is the way we build them now. And didn't I love to know?
It was changing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And your notion of the pie, the square both corners, couldn't we also say that at times, warmth is important, but at other times, warmth is an answer. Something that's pertinent in Arizona is, in fact, the opposite here. We have winter mortality, and deer there isn't nearly as big a concern. Mm-hmm. So conditions vary, and this bee that isn't naturally supposed to be from here at all, it's an invasive visitor that's useful. I think that we have to be plastic in how we care for bees and how we choose our bees, as well as how we house them.
Yeah, we have to be plastic. That's a good word. And yes, Apis mellifera came with humans to this... No, sorry, that was really bad. Apis mellifera came with Europeans to this country. So what are we doing about us, right? The whole topic of invasive is so, I don't know my way, I cannot navigate it anymore. It's so complicated. But still, you know, we have to remember Apis mellifera, all a subspecies, doesn't only come out of a four-season climate, right? We have, how's it called? The bee in Egypt, Apis, it's in the same family, right? So that's Egypt, or the Italian Apis, Italian bees, right? They're coming not out of a four-season climate all the way. So I think in terms of climate zones, and yet, when it comes to forage, and, well, spirit, it's very different here. But still, there are some principles they are applicable to any kind of climate zone when it comes to instinctual needs and preferences. And the corner is doesn't, the corners are not in the genetic makeup of Apis mellifera. And yet, you're right, they are different climate zones, and it is important to take them into consideration.
So it's just as I'm sitting here thinking about, you know, Varroa, like a lot of us, if we're keeping bees in a Langstroth hive with, you know, four, five, six hives maybe in a yard together, then knowing what we know about these observations of the shape and stuff, it is kind of my responsibility, though, at that point, to manage the Varroa mite, because they won't survive. My bees will die if I don't. So, you know what I mean? So that's another way of looking at it. It's not necessarily saying don't use Langstroth, although I might be moving in that direction, but if I am, I have set up a condition where my bees will not thrive in the presence of Varroa. And so then it becomes my responsibility to either change how I'm keeping the bees, or I have to manage the mites.
Yeah, thank you very much for sharing that. That's why I said it is hard to shift to another way because of that. Because we feel we're devastated when bees die. And how dare I come and say, more or less, let them die. You know, but I'm not saying that like that. But also, that what appears to be as if it's a responsibility to treat, to keep alive. Another, when we shift the vantage point, what it means is that we are weakening a system, and we are promoting a weaker and weaker system, which will affect all the bees around us.
Yes.
It's all of a sudden, it's not just those bees in front of us. We have what I said earlier, we touch bees, we touch 7,000 acres. Whatever we do has such an impact in all 10 directions. So it's not black and white at all. You know, and yes, there's so much that can be done within the Langstroth system, but how can we adapt? Like, just to run it as one deep. Mm-hmm. One run deep, and don't put them next to each other, and let them swarm, and then catch the swarms, without having to sit there and wait. But think about ways where it can link to instinctual preferences and have it all happen on its own, through working with density principles.
And what I'm talking about is what I call the landscape apiarium. It's just an odd word just to get us out of our old mind. So let's say, here's your colony, and you will just have it keep it small. So that's okay. One way of integrating all those principles would be small. Oh no, we should say, let's say 10 gallons. One meat box. Okay? And now next thing we do is if we live on some land, then we look at a distance of, let's say, 100 to 300 yards or meters. And we set up a hive box, an empty hive box. And we do the same here, we do the same here, we do the same here. Now, if it follows your farm, you can do it, it's easy. But if your land is only like this big, right? Then the beauty of this is, as totally 21st century zeitgeist, is to link, to network, to enter the web of other people.
Mm.
And you walk to your neighbor, or whoever it is, and say, hey, by the way, you want to become part of my landscape apiary? You know what I mean? So again, how can we be creative? How can we work creatively with those principles? So I don't feel constricted by living only on an acre. I live on an acre myself. But I have neighbors. And I talk to my neighbors. So you do this. Multiple ones. And then you have even talked about other principles, one of which is height. You know, they want to be, let's call it 12 to 18 feet off the ground. So those boxes, you know, the more we integrate those principles, the more intimate we connect with that life gesture. So, or in other words, I put it in a tree or on a balcony, and it makes it more likely for that swarm to move in. Because his first preference is high off the ground. That's first preference, that's second preference. Mm. Okay? And then, you know, you could, and this doesn't have to be a log in a tree, you could just use another deep lecture box with no bees in it, and nothing. Ideally, it's a box which has been used before, bees have lived in it, it just smells so strong. And then it's productive, and if you want to work with natural palm, then I would suggest level that box, right? Because, let me ask you that. Who of you is working with natural palm? Okay. So when you switch to natural palm, one thing you need to put in your tool box is a level. Because, like I said at the beginning, they know exactly the gravitational field and it's straight down. The plane of a frame, if you have a frame, the frame has to sit plumb in the hive so that bees would grow home in the plane of the frame. If it's not, then it will cross over. Okay? It's very simple. So you don't have to do that if you check on that box every day or if someone has an eye on it, because if the swarm moves in, then you can move it. That make sense? So, and that, I think that's a beautiful way, one beautiful option for you when you work with this. And then here's the problem. We are working with time, and the other word is, what's this word? Oh my God, it's embarrassing. I don't think the word, I don't know. That's, anyway. What I'm trying to, I want to say something with one single word, I can't, it's not there. What I'm going to say is, we have such a fast-paced environment in life, and we want instant gratification. But
patience?
Once we enter that way, we are working with time. You have to be patient. Maybe that's one word. I was looking for another. Patience. And if you have only one hive, and it's alive now, that's good news, right?
Mm-hmm.
That by now, I assume it's pretty safe to say, if you're alive now, you're good. You're good to go. Mm-hmm. So that's a great starting point. If your sweetheart is alive, you could experiment with this. Okay? That is a beautiful choice. And so that's all part of what I call the concept of a landscape of the area. And now it makes sense to call it a global honeybee reserve, because the moment we protect natural
instinctual needs and preferences, it honors and protects that life form. I don't know what my next bullets are. Okay, so we are, for this we are redefining the paradigm of apiculture through the integration of the fundamental instinctual preferences of Apis mellifera. We have to identify those life principles, and then only are we able to incorporate them. And then we're talking about birthrights, and to return that birthright of national complete integrity, which, you know, has multiple aspects and layers to it. And then once we are at that place, how can we mirror their life gesture in design and management? And then, you know, that is a little bit, how can we design self-sustaining apiaries with wild honeybees adding as a core element? If you live somewhere with some wild landscapes, it's very likely that you do, that you may have wild Apis mellifera living in the woods. So how can we link to it? Or if not, how can we provide nest habitat? And that's what I'm doing a lot. I'm setting up nest habitat, empty log hives. I inoculate them and place them in wild landscape or semi-cultivated landscapes, just to link, to provide habitat. And then once occupied, we can link, because then all of a sudden we can have a man-made, an artificial hive, the swarm box for those wild Apis mellifera.
What did you mean by inoculate? You said you inoculate?
Yes. Well, it's just a way of describing how to add scent and make it attractive. One way of doing it is to make a concoction.
Concoction.
Yeah. Or, with out of propolis and alcohol. And then the tincture, that's easier to say. A tincture, and then I put the tincture in a spray bottle and mist the inside. If it's an unused, if it's an unused hive, you can do it with a limestone hive too, a new one. If you want to use it as a swarm catcher, I spray it and the alcohol evaporates and it leaves behind a very thin layer of propolis, and that's our scent. So that's why I call it inoculation.
Do you use lemongrass oil?
I know people use lemongrass oil. I just, why not using that? Why not using the substance from the bees? I never used it. I know it works. You know, but I don't know. I like to use original tissue in some way.
Do you consider bees that are living in buildings wild hives? We have we have old Shaker buildings near us, and there's been hives in there for years and years. Oh. And that's just like such an interesting thing, because nobody's managing that.
Yes.
And they are going for year after year after year and looking for new houses to like live in. So we have those all around us.
Linked to them.
Well, absolutely. And the other thing is, one thing that I've been really concerned about for my bees, and I can just like, they're telling me, and they're telling me very strongly, is a concern about available forage. Like, we live in like the typical wooded, meadowed areas, just like here. We're in New York, so we're not far from Cornell or the Steiner School.
Yeah.
But there's so much goldenrod. It's so prolific that spring buildup and midsummer, it's just like, where are the flowers? So a lot of my energy is going into cultivating forage.
Yeah.
But I'm concerned about the number of hives within a given area for the amount of actual forage. It looks like there's a lot of forage because it's all natural, but in fact, a lot of that stuff is just trees that the bees aren't remotely interested in.
It's interesting, it happened to me too, that I had bees in an area last year with the California drought. I thought, oh my goodness, they won't make it. And oh my God, this is full with honey. Where's this coming from? Who put that in there? when I followed, all I could see was trees and not a single blossom.
Right.
So we have to be careful,
right.
You know, is it a true evaluation?
Yeah.
And the bees will tell you.
The bees are telling me, and I have gone out in our woods with a naturalist and a few other people,
yes.
And looked for the right trees. And we have a little bit of a problem where we are. So I'm trying to get people to get into seed making clubs and things,
yes.
And just actually just giving seeds away and giving
yes.
plants away and asking people to cultivate them.
Yes.
But do you have a sense of how much actual forage needs to be available to how many hives in a given area?
I really don't have good data on that one. It depends on, is it a four-season climate like here, is it in California, where there are periods in late summer where there's not much, but then eucalyptus starts blooming in December for 6 months. You know, so it really depends. It's hard to there may be other people who have a good answer for that, but I don't. And just one more thing about your barn bees or the bees, the wild bees and structures. I get often called and say, oh, I have a problem, I have bees in my wall. I say, oh, how lucky you are. Like, oh, auspicious. You're congratulations. To protect those and to educate people. People have all kinds of worries and concerns, but to congratulate them and to educate and then to link to those bees. Through that way, what is one possibility?
Well, we've had a neighbor ask us to come and cut the bees out of their
yeah.
wall, and we look
yeah.
at the job, and it's going to be huge.
Yes.
And I'm wondering, what's the problem?
Yeah. And
what can I say to them to help them get more relaxed about the fact the bees are in their wall?
Is it high up?
Oh, it's
no?
really high up. I
oh.
mean, you can get to it from a room. I mean, you can go upstairs
yeah.
in the house, and I can hear them with a stethoscope through the wall.
Yeah.
But I know.
I'm melting.
Right. I was like, why do you want to leave? Like, my partner's like, well, we really have to leave. I said, no, just let me listen more.
Yeah, let them listen. Let them listen.
Yeah, that
but
might be a good idea.
Just be creative.
Well,
it's
I'm thinking
so
in May
it's
when
it's so
it
easy to sell because you can say, for example, what I say is, oh my God, you know, the survival of the world is hinging on the survival of honeybees. By
on your house.
If you, and then make a spiel, I always make a spiel on the wild bees are the ones who survive. And that combined, by allowing those bees to be where they are, you are becoming a savior.
They're not going to damage their house in any way.
No,
I mean, it's
nothing.
Like whatever they're living in was already the way it was.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you have to bear with me my language. It's not Apis mellifera, it's not Apis mellifica, it's not Apis arborea, now it's Apis sophia. It's like, oh, that crazy guy. So, but every word represents a different aspect of bees. And Apis sophia, the wisdom aspect of this, is a whole other layer. How, you know, we don't have time for all the way, but I wanted to at least mention it. So Apis sophia is the study of honeybees and how it relates to us in the world. And it has to do with community, culture, economics, ecology, agriculture, or emotional well-being. It's so multi-layered. And also, it has to do with, on a very fundamental level, our sense of self, who we think we are in this world, and in which ways Apis arborea can be a timely inspiration for us in a time of global crisis to find and develop new ways, new sustainable ways of being in the world, within the biosphere and with each other. Through the study of this being and how, as an individual, its life is completely dedicated to the well-being of all. and that it's that is its sense of self. It is, it defines itself through the other. It is the other. So just, you know, the theme, the inner theme of this phenomenon has to do with the challenges we are working on right now. How to find sustainable ways of living through a different sense of self. The more we feel separate and the less we can see oneself in the world, then the deeper the degree of alienation and the deeper the degree of suffering. Mm-hmm. So there's lots of wisdom teaching in there. And maybe one more thing about it. We can also reverse it in some ways and say, if we wanted to understand this phenomenon on the deepest level, we would be only able to do so through an inner transformation. You know, we talked about left and right hemisphere earlier. Through the vision of becoming more intimate with bees is a way of becoming intimate with our own soul, with our own true nature, with the fullness of life we may be lacking. And the lack of that, what I call right now fullness of life, may be one of the causes for alienation and suffering and also destruction. Or, yeah, you know, I think maybe we spend the rest of the time with questions, but I think that's it for now. Yeah.
Are you familiar with the horizontal five, the double deep horizontal, the dual wells and times five?
What's the name?
The dual wells and times.
Oh, yes.
Horizontal double deep five, it's a double wall insulated.
Yes.
Five, because I'm going to try to build with you.
Yes.
And keep these for the first time this
year. Oh, that's wonderful. You will love it.
I hope so.
Because that was my favorite frame types for a long time. And what it is, I think that's true for him too, it's a European frame, but it's rotated upright. So we have a tall frame, and then I'm working with something which is related, and it's called golden height or one room height. It's the equivalent. And it's just a long box, it is a box, with 20 frames, and that's it. End of the story. Big wood, nice insulation on top, but it's just one room, no food room.
Right, I want to try that. See.
And, you know,
how wide are your top lines on
those? 35 millimeters, 1 1/4.
1 1/4.
Isn't that standard, 1 1/4?
1 2/8, I think.
Next trip is 1 3/8.
I don't know.
Okay, whatever it is.
What's that guy called?
The Lancer?
Lazutan. L-A-Z-U-T-I-N. He wrote a book called PQDs with a Smile.
Yeah.
And they have a website, horizontalhive.com.
Keeping Bees with a Smile. If you Google that title, the book pops up. Shoot, I want to say, oh, you know, just one little thing about supering. Speaking of, you know, to return to principles, sorry, but it's just all there is. Okay, so we start with one box, and this being grows downward, right? Downward. So everything positions itself, that's a funny way of saying it, But everything is then honey, uterus, you know, it's like this is the top. This is the top of the world. There's nothing but this. And all processes are framed according to the setup and controls downwards. Now what happens with an empty volume on top? So we have total nest integrity, or we have some sort of nest integrity here, and now we put a box above. It annihilates everything which grew here. Everything. And this, I want to give you just one example when it comes to warmth, right? Touts in the book. What they did, they looked at different areas within the uterus, and they found the temperature, there are areas of different temperatures. And then they looked at the bees hatching one of those different temperature zones within the uterus and found that they were different bees. They had different properties and skills. In other words, the temperature of the uterus is extremely precisely controlled. Temperature is key. Okay, now, just imagine you are a bee and you're trying to maintain this very precise temperature, and all of a sudden someone comes and gives you empty volume in May, and at night it's 42. And that's just one example, right? The other one is, it's like an oak tree wants its roots in the ground, and the branches pointing to the earth, the sky, right? Well, by doing this, everything has to be reversed. And now, comb is not starting to grow this way. No, now we have to, this is a stressful impact, and they have to compensate. So they have to develop enough tissue to jump up and grow down again. When we have the option of doing this with zero impact to nadir, it's called nadir, zero impact, they just continue.
That's what the board is on top.
Yes, exactly. And that's why the board is doing it. Another question?
So could you do that with the leech drop, you think, at the box below?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. With any vertical hive, yeah.
And I actually have another question as well.
Yeah.
So I know this sort of contradicts some of what we've been doing. We already have like larger hives, multiple boxes, so we already have a lot of volume in our hives. So I was wondering what you thought about artificial blue grapes as a method of like mite control. And since we have large hives, we're not necessarily having too much swarming, depending on that.
Right. So how would it look like? What you call that artificial blue introduction?
Most
grapes.
Yes.
Sometimes.
Yeah, like being made in the past.
Got it.
So there's a bit of a blue grape. Out and they have the queen cells
right.
Still in there.
Right, so you're always spinning once you have queen cells?
That's what we try our method, but that was the method that we had success.
But you're not putting unifying queens.
We have. But we're trying to learn how to
Well, you know, I'm complicated. Right. Because my reference point is wild conditions. That's my reference point. And I did split in the past. But I cannot do it anymore. And then one gentleman he brought up, is that it? Will that, he brought up that issue of spinning in wood direction. And yeah, it helps, but it's the whole, it's not the whole story. So the question is, how far do you want to go? You know? And from studying this phenomenon, this is a process of swarming. It's related to gestation and procreation. And the whole process where, like, as a female human, this is huge. This is not just plugging in something and then it comes out as a baby, right? It's like, oh my God, your whole being is being transformed. I mean, on all levels. You know, you all of a sudden you have a belly, you can feel at some point a human being moving in your uterus. That is so crazy. Oh my God. I hope I will be reincarnated as a woman next time. I want to feel it. So, and then your hormones are totally different, but your mind changes too. It's, and your glands, your breasts start growing, and all of a sudden they make milk. It's like, it changes. Your whole being is transformed. And that's true for this mammalian being too. Like the queen, for this wonderful example, and I don't know the full story, the queen's preparing to fly, right? So she has to lose weight. She's not being fed before that. Just as one little... So, and then the other thing which can be problematic is you move comb with your spirit. You bring baggage. And also you shuffle. And don't take it as a judgment. It's just when you, all what I'm trying to do is to have wild beasts around us. That's all I'm trying to do for animals. And again, how much do you feel drawn to integrating? How many aspects of that? And you may want to start just with a few, like density issues, you know? Your hives are probably next to each other. How can you, now you saw the data, maybe that's one area you want to work with, or who knows where it is. But you could start easy. You don't have to throw your life away. Or not. You know what I mean? So then it's go with what feels right for you. Yes?
With your method of putting the four swarm boxes around, how many swarms would you lose? So I'm new to beekeeping.
Yeah.
I don't want to sit out all month and watch. But will I be likely to catch my swarms?
I think it's very likely, but nothing is 100%, right? And the more you link to those preferences, don't put them on the ground, put them in a tree, somewhere high, do multiple ones, the higher... I think four is an awesome number.
Okay.
Yes?
So when you have like the second box there and then you go underneath, is that that the ear cell's gonna move down and then go to all the other box?
Say it again, then you're not here and then what?
The uterus, will that also move down to the other box? Or will it stay in the top box?
That is the natural gesture that it would go. And that's interesting because then different functions move through different comb areas, right?
So then the other question is, it wouldn't matter how many boxes you have, you could just put a bunch of empty boxes beneath it, they would just slowly grow down.
Yes. But then you have to think about nest volume.
Right.
But yes. And that's why the Russian hive, or the golden hive, what it does, it's almost an 18-inch frame. And it allows this brood or comb integrity. Because here, in this system, the lifestyle system, what is it? Is it 8 inch deep frame?
9 and 8 inch deep.
So the problem here is you have an interruption. You have wood, space, wood. You have, I don't know, it's probably 2 inches or more. Where this brood, this comb is disconnected from the top of that. Does that make sense? And the golden hive, that's why they just rotated this upward.
I live in the middle of a forest. I planted deodar and a bunch of other kind of flowers. And so, you know, the summer I have just gorgeous. They're doing the deodar thing. But now I'm wondering, maybe they're wild bees. I don't know if anybody that had beehives around. I mean, how kind of would I follow them or find out?
You know, Thomas Seeley is about to publish a book. It's maybe called Bee Lining or so.
Oh, yeah, they used to be old bee boxes.
The little boxes.
My friend has a whole collection of antique bee boxes.
Oh, really? For bee lining?
Yeah.
And that gave me an idea. I want to buy it myself because, you know, he worked so much with finding wild bees in a huge forest. It's been a short YouTube video out there right now. But that if you feel inclined to do so, beeline, or just watch the bees. Watch the bees where they're coming from. And a good way of doing it is when you can see them well, so the dark backdrop. So if you have forest beginning there, you stay here. And there's line between you and the forest is a little bit shaded, and you look and see, oh, there are bees going back and forth between your flowers, and you look, oh, which direction they go. That gives you a rough idea. But remember, they can come from quite far. And that's what we did in the old days. We would look for the bees in the woods and go there and go to the bees. Yeah. Yes.
Well, I was thinking about log hives and using, I grow the vine extraverde, the one that he used that they like. I was thinking about making a slurry and spraying it inside, because in a natural tree there is mycelium, which they use to boost their nutrients.
Absolutely.
What do you think? Do you think that would be a good idea?
It's two-sided for me. For me, what I look at is Paul Stannard is doing wonderful work, wonderful research with mycelium. But all of a sudden, think mycelium. Mycelium, it's all about cooperation, integration, all those principles of it. And then what I think is this is taken out and made into an allopathic substance. It loses all its value. I think it's working with this being of mycelium, which is unbelievably it's interconnecting worlds and plant and animal kingdoms, and it's essential to our survival. And then you take the substance and try to kill the world. It's the same thing happening where you take the new paradigm and put it back into the old. You know, the other problem is that whenever we end up with a substance, we will not change conditions. There's no awareness of density, for example. Just to separate two hives is more effective than you to use any substance. And also, it's about the long-term process of host and parasite. and to reduce it to an allopathic treatment, whether it's mycelium, whether it's organic acids, it's a mismatch. It will produce, it will end up with a reverse result. So I see the impulse and the wanting to do good, but with a beautiful, out of a beautiful environment. As long as you use it just as a health supporting ingredient, sure. But the moment you make it into something which gets rid of mites, it becomes the opposite of medicine. It becomes poison.
It's dependency.
I talked to him. Sorry. Yes.
I had a question about your time for aromites, and there was you said that at one point they lived with it was like wild bees.
Yes.
That they lived kind of like harmoniously, and I was wondering is that just in a natural setting, or was that in trying to domesticate bees? Where did this occur? Where did they take place? Where did this take place?
Where
aromites lived harmoniously with wild bees?
Oh, it's in the Arnold Reserve.
Okay, so that was
Arnold, Arnold, I believe, Reserve, and it's in upstate New York. And if you Google Thomas Seeley Arnold Reserve, there's a four-page PDF, which gives you a beautiful overview of what he did there.
And does your website or have information on making a log hive? Because I know I'm interested.
In, yeah.
Like, who do you recommend? What resources do you recommend?
Yeah. I think it's under, on my webpage, there's a alternative hives at the bottom. Thank you. on the bottom is a video where I show how someone is making a log hive. And that's, again, just one way of doing it. There are other ways too. And if you go to on Facebook, National Beekeeping Trust in England, they're doing wonderful things. And then you can go to Cyclair Tree Beekeeping on Facebook. And that is an explosive, meaning it grows so fast, a global movement of people who are pursuing this approach in working with log hives, but also reviving very, very old traditions. That's why that funny word, cycler, it's an old Middle European word, which is a way of keeping working with bees in trees and creating tree cavities in live trees. In a very skillful way. It's an old craft which had almost disappeared. There were very few people left in Eastern Europe, and people found them and started, preserving that craft. And now it's just everybody is right now. In the last 2 years, this took off, and I'm still hoping to organize a gathering, a workshop where. We would learn how to do that. Maybe in the fall, I don't know. But you see, it's interesting how this impulse comes and goes back to those very basics.
Are you from Germany?
I am, yeah.
We heard rumors.
Not about you. But that in Germany,
bee houses where people go sit and get healed?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are. I find it so fascinating because there are probably several. I know one which is situated in Bavaria, in southern Germany, and that person started experimenting with the scent of the hive.
Oh my gosh.
And now the people are flocking to him in his little bee house. And it's just so beautiful in this conservative Bavarian setting. People flock to breathe in hive air. Mm-hmm. And people are getting cured. People with asthma, allergies, and it's endless. And it's, you know, rediscovering the old medicinal aspects of this phenomenon.
It's also very, very big in Slovenia.
Oh, right.
Huge.
Yeah. So,
if you want to see a bee house, if you'd like to see a bee house, you can see mine in New Hampshire.
You got some in New Hampshire?
So, we are already a bit over time, right? I'm sorry about this, but I have to say one more thing. You mind? Which is related to log hives and no frames. Correct? Mm-hmm. No one asked that question. So, the question would have been like,
isn't that illegal?
Thank you. So, it's illegal. You will go to prison when you allow bees to live the way bees would like to live. No, you're not going to prison. But it feels like it. When you think about that regulation, all 50 states adopted that regulation, that the brood, the uterus, has to be on movable frames so they can be inspected. Okay? Because of the brood diseases. This, and we talked about it. So, okay, now let's look at this briefly, but I feel like it's important because, you know, people would like to experiment, so we need to look at this. And this is how it goes. Okay, so there, once upon a time, there was an issue, and people thought like, okay, we put in this regulation to take care of the issue. What was the issue? Brood diseases. Oh, what is causing brood disease? Instead of looking at the causes, we just wanted to make sure, oh, okay, they need to be inspected. What are the causes of brood diseases? Right when our dear Mr. Langstroth started this revolution of beekeeping, things shifted and brood diseases were more frequent. And people called foul brood, not foul brood, they called it the beekeeper's disease. It's the beekeeper's disease because what it is, it reflects management. It reflects not taking care of an animal and it gets sick. It's called the beekeeper's disease. But instead of outlawing the beekeeper's disease's causes, we outlawed the birthright of this being, of being itself. We outlawed the integrity of life. Okay, so that's one thing, okay? Now, I want to look at the other thing, and that makes me so... makes me so emotional, sorry. I want to look at commercial beekeeping.
Oh my God.
Which is, have you seen the movie More Than Honey? Yeah. Who has not seen More Than Honey? Look it up. More Than Honey. It's on Netflix. And look what is done to this sacred being. So, I needed to say that to put things in perspective. And now it's an easy sell to follow ethics and moral. And just it feels like human rights, animal rights. That's what it is about. It's about animal rights.
Co-creation rights.
Yeah, it is. And then further down, it's about the entire biosphere is at stake. That's my two cents when it comes to that topic.
Mm. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sorry for my... Mm-hmm. All right, I think that's it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.